Well, today Bishop is going to continue into the Ephesians series, and we just really going to believe God's going to continue to anoint him. See, one thing I like about God, he never does things the same. He always does greater. That's why he multiplies and he adds too. And I'm just expecting God to do greater things through this man of God when he comes this morning. But I want to let those that are on the ranch and those that are watching my closed circuit TV on death row, those that are watching from, I think it's H Block, I want you to know that if you made a decision yesterday during the altar call, we want you to put your name on a piece of paper and send it to Chaplain Earl Smith, because we want to hear from you. We want to include you. We don't want you to be left out of this. And we just thank God that the same anointing, the same spirit that is dwelling in this place is reaching it. See, that's the kind of God we serve. See, he's not limited to just a chapel. See, he can go into death row. He can go on down the ranch through closed circuit TV. He can go to H Block. He can go throughout this whole institution, because we serve an awesome, awesome, awesome God. But we want to get started this morning. We just want to, again, on behalf of Bishop T.D. Jakes, we want to welcome you to this Ephesians series. We thank God for you, and we just pray that God is not only challenging you, but changing you. So we don't just want to be challenged, we want to be changed. And we want to start our service this morning by asking Brother Al to come and lead us in a word of prayer.
Come on, stand to your feet this morning. Just give Brother hand praise there.
Healed. And only one of them came back to say thank you and maintained his healing. So I believe that by his gratitude, he maintained his healing and the relationship he had with Jesus Christ. So I wanted to, before we finish today, I just want to show my gratitude. I could do it on the phone. I could do it on the email. I could do it when we get back home. But I just want to confirm our relationship by saying, Bishop, we're thankful that you come to San Quentin. We appreciate it. We really do. Come on, are you thankful? So we together want to confirm our relationship by saying thank you. We appreciate you. All right? Don't ever want to be unthankful. Hallelujah. All right, hold up. We want to move on. You guys are a blessing, man. But I also want to say thank you to Jacqueline Cedric that came. And she's doing some publishing stuff for us, and she's just a real blessing. We had a great time, and to Marcus and Pastor Jimmy. See, I know these guys, but, you know, I just want them to know that we appreciate them. I know they came because Bishop told them, but, you know, I know they also expressed a loving concern. I could tell by the way they was mingling with people and the way they ministering. And to Sean and Reese, we just thank you guys. We appreciate you. We really do. And this morning, I just want to have the privilege to say, you know, every morning I read a Proverbs, because there's a lot of wisdom in Proverbs. And in Proverbs, it tells you a lot about a wife. It says that in Proverbs, you should rejoice with the wife of your youth in chapter 5. And then in chapter 12, it says a virtuous woman is a crown to a husband, but a contentious woman is like dripping water. And then in chapter 18, it says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. And then in chapter 19, it says that houses and inheritance are from fathers, but a good wife, a virtuous woman, is from the Lord. And then in Proverbs 31, it tells us about that virtuous woman. Well, gentlemen and ladies, I want to introduce the wife of my youth, my Proverbs 31 woman. She is the one that God has blessed me to find favor with. And she is indeed a crown to her husband. I want to introduce Minister Ruth Fitzgerald.
Praise the Lord. Amen. December 31st, 5 minutes to midnight. I sat on a couch in a fetal position, trying to decide which way I was going to take my life. You probably are asking yourself, why would she want to take her life? Well, there I was, 35 years old. And I had no desire to go on another year living the way that I was living. I could not stand to look in the mirror. I didn't like who I was. Here was an individual who was empty on sight, and I wondered as I sat back and began to go through my life, how did I end up in such a situation? You see, I was born into a welfare home, just my mom. Never knew my dad. And you know, I didn't realize until I came to Jesus Christ that I lived in a dysfunctional home, that I lived in a home that there was no emotion shown, and there was never the touch or hug nor kisses or someone to say, I love you, Ruth. So as I sat there, I was empty. I mean, there was no reason for me to live. There was no purpose for me to exist. I began to try to reason. I couldn't understand this thing, how you could just grow up and then maybe find a boyfriend and then have a baby and then get a job and finish high school and work this job 40 or 50 years and then maybe become a grandmother and then retire and then die. You see, I had the opportunity to take any kind of drug. I started drinking at the age of 13, and then that evolved into heavier drugs. And you know, I thank God today that His hand was on me, because I was so foolish, you know. I remember one night driving down the FDR Drive in New York, going to a disco club where 30 minutes prior, I had dropped a tab of mescaline, betting that it was going to hit me when I got to the disco, but it didn't. It hit me on the FDR Drive. And in my foolishness, I cried out to a God I did not know and asked Him if He could just get me to the disco, I'd be all right. Amen. And He did, because He knew there was a plan for my life. Amen. But then, you know, I think I shared with you yesterday about a man impregnated a young girl and then went on because he was into addiction. Well, I was that young girl who got pregnant at the age of 17, fell in love with a young man who I saw who had potential but had no direction. And then when I had my child, it was a baby boy, I said, I need to find a father for this baby. And so then I went and I began to pick, and I picked a man. Not a man that I love, but a man that I thought that I could change to be a father. But of course, you know, that does not work either, men. Amen. Wrong motivation. That was not God's plan for marriage or relationships. Well, that marriage ended in a divorce and with another baby boy. Here I am, a young woman with two baby boys. I have a wonderful career in a major corporation. Worked in that corporation for 18 and a half years. On the outside, if you had saw me, you would thought I was the most happiest young woman. You see, I had been everywhere and done everything. But on the inside, I had such a void. See, the only thing that I knew about Jesus was that He was in the manger. But I didn't know about the Jesus that went on the cross and the power of His resurrection. See, when the church came to tell me about that Jesus, they were the same people that were hanging out with me on Saturday night, doing the crack, the cocaine, and the herbs, and everything else. And you see, I used to be a Black Panther. So if I'm going to get involved in anything, I've got to go all the way. Amen? And I can vividly remember myself saying, I can't wait to go to hell. Because I thought it was just going to be one big party. Foolish. The minute I came to my senses that night, I realized I don't want to go there. And Lord, don't let anyone else go that I tried to send there. Amen. But anyway, that night as I contemplated killing myself, there was such torment, which many of you have already experienced and may be experiencing now, where the enemy is in agreement with your decision. I was in turmoil, desperation. But as I sat there in that fetal position, a small, quiet voice said, Ruth, if you would trust me, I will turn your life around. It was nothing that I've ever heard before. So calm, so peaceful, so quiet. And it was though time had stopped just for me. I looked at the clock, it was 1 minute. I said, I'm going to trust this. I'm going to trust this. That night, I asked Jesus Christ to come into my life, and He has kept His agreement. He's turned my life around. See, He knew that I was supposed to be here in the 21st century to upset some stuff. He knew. He knew. Yes, amen. He knew when he got my mom and dad together that he was looking into the 21st century and the plan and the destination that I was be going. And even though I couldn't recognize it at that moment, he called my name and I heard him. And today he's calling somebody's name. He's calling somebody's name. I have the opportunity to go and minister to men, women, and children in prison. It is my heart. It is my passion. It is my desire. I feel like I'm a hunter because every time I walk into a place behind bars, I'm looking for treasure. Because I don't see mess. I see gold. I see diamonds. I see rubies. I see emeralds. I see amethysts. Oh, and you're so beautiful. I imagine the father looking down and saying, look at my babies, my jewels, if they would just know how valuable they are to me. One of the things that God... One of the things God has placed on my life for the 21st century, for the saint behind the wall, is that they must be soldiers. Amen? You must have a soldier mentality about what you believe in. And as soldiers, we're raising them up around the world. And this is a confession. And I'm going to leave this confession here with Chaplain Earl so that you can join in with the rest of the offenders behind bars. And I'm going to share it with you. But I want this to become so strong in your heart because you heard Bishop talk last night about the revival. The revival is in you. And when you change, they will change. Amen. I'm a soldier in the army of my God. The Lord Jesus Christ is my commanding officer. The Holy Bible is my code of conduct. Faith, prayer, and the word are my weapons of warfare. I've been taught by the Holy Spirit, trained by experience, tried by adversity, and tested by fire. I'm a volunteer in this army, and I'm enlisted for eternity. I will either retire in this army at the rapture or die in this army. I will not get out, sell out, be talked out, or pushed out. I'm faithful, reliable, capable, and dependable. If my God needs me, I'm there. If he needs me in San Quentin, he can use me because I'm here. I'm a soldier. I'm not a baby. I do not need to be pampered, petted, primed up, pumped up, picked up, or pepped up. I'm a soldier. No one has to call me, remind me, write me, visit me, entice me, or lure me. I am a soldier. I'm not a wimp. I'm in place, saluting my king, obeying his orders and praising his name and building his kingdom. No one has to send me flowers, gifts, food, cards, candy, or give me handouts. I do not need to be cuddled, cradled, cared for, or catered to. I am committed. I cannot have my feelings hurt bad enough to turn me around. I cannot be discouraged enough to turn me aside. I cannot lose enough to cause me to quit. When Jesus called me into this army, I had nothing. If I end up with nothing, I will still come out ahead. I will win. My God has and will continue to supply all of my needs. I'm more than a conqueror. I will always triumph. I can do all things through Christ. Devils cannot defeat me. People cannot delusion me. Weather cannot weary me. Sickness cannot stop me. Battles cannot beat me. Money cannot buy me. Hell cannot handle me. I am a soldier. Even death cannot destroy me. For when my commander calls me from this battlefield, he will promote me to captain and then allow me to rule with him. I'm a soldier in the army and I'm marching, claiming victory. I will not give up. I will not turn around. I am a soldier marching heaven bound. Here I stand. Will you stand with me? Men at St. Quentin, I want you to be encouraged. You're the new breed. You're the remnant children that God is raising up. We need you to get your life in order and in right. Because one of the things you're going to learn is that being a male is a matter of birth, but being a man is a matter of choice. God has placed before you the decisions and placed everything in you to become the man of God He's created and desired you to be. Amen. So my call to you right now is wake up and be the man that God has called you to be. Amen. It is an esteem, honor, and a privilege for me to be able to introduce this man of God. Bishop Jakes, an apostle, special messenger of Christ Jesus. By the divine will, the purpose and choice of God, to the saints at St. Quentin, the consecrated ones, the set apart ones, and those who are also faithful and loyal and steadfast in Christ Jesus. I ask that you would pray that whenever Bishop Jakes opens his mouth, words may be given that he will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. Gentlemen, Bishop T.D. Jakes.
What's going on, gentlemen? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Make a song out of anything. You may be seated. Thank you. Yeah. Ready to do it. How many blessed men do we have in the room? Amen. We're excited to have an opportunity to share with you and to the men who are listening to me through the intercom systems and watching on closed circuit TV. This is a day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. I'm excited to have an opportunity to pick up where we left off. And I'm going to share some things. I'm going to move around a bit because as I began to pray about it last night, I've only got this session today and the one this afternoon. And I've got like several chapters to cover. So I won't get finished, and I realized that when I came here, but I really thought it was an opportunity to take seriously prison ministry. I'm not sure that we always do that. I think it becomes, from a Christian perspective, crisis management, where it's always just a matter of either evangelism or counseling or encouragement or trying to use the message to control behavior, and whereas the message left to itself will control behavior, so we don't have to manipulate the message to control behavior or use it for our own means. It's just truth, and if you teach people truth, they begin to walk in truth, and it becomes something you can use now It's something you can use later, something you can use when you get out, something you can use on this side and on the other side, and in between, this doesn't change. Don't have to fix it for black men and then change it for white men and then change it for Hispanic men. Makes no difference. Indian men, it's just truth. It's just transferable truth, something you can sink your teeth into and build your life on. And so I'm excited to share it with you. I was raised in a home. My mother was very, very well educated, and she didn't never talk baby talk to us. She never did walk in the room talking about goo goo gaga. You know, she always talked to you like you were a thinking, intelligent person. And guess what? People become what you talk to them like. If you talk to them like animals, they become animals. If you talk to them like trash, they become trash. If you talk to them like men, they become men. If you talk to them like they're intelligent, they become intelligent. People rise or fall according to the level that you communicate. And so I came to you, and I didn't really come to talk to you just as inmates. I came to talk to you as men of God. Mm-hmm. And I was checking somewhere, either in your warehouse, they think it's in the warehouse, if it's not there already, it will be shortly, are several series of my books on Ephesians. I've got like 6 books on the wealth walk, warfare, workmanship, and wedding of the believer that are going to be available to you to use and to study and to read and to finish. Amen. Amen. I also want to send back several copies of the book, The Great Investment. It's a new book. It's not even out yet. The people on the outside don't have it, but I'm going to send it to you. Anyway. It deals with faith, family, and finances. The greatest investments you'll ever make in your life is into your faith, into your family, and into your finance. And I focus specifically as it relates to family on non-traditional families. Even in here, you can have a family. How many men in here have children? Amen. How many men in here write your children? Yeah. Keep talking to your kids, no matter what. Even if they're not talking back, keep talking to your kids. Keep reaching after your kids. You can make a difference. With a letter, with a pen. All we're reading, gentlemen, is the letter of our spiritual fathers that we call a Bible, written by inmates locked in jail who ran the church from behind prison walls. Think of it, the whole book of Ephesians is a letter written by an inmate. So you could make a difference with your pen. And when Paul was waiting to be executed and locked up on the death row of his time, he wrote to Timothy and said, send me a book and send me a coat and send me some paper. Because even in the final moments of his life, he was still writing notes that would change the world. The power of the pen is an incredible thing. And don't feel like because you're not there physically that you have a right to be missing in action. You still have an obligation to father your child as best you can from where you are with what you've got. And even if they write back foolish notes or seem like they don't want to be bothered, someday when they grow up or grow older or grow more mature, they'll look for your letters because they're gonna need a daddy. Just like we did. So don't forget your kids. And don't become an animal. Don't become an animal. Animals have sex and don't have families. Make it a family. Make it work. No matter how dysfunctional it is, invest in your family. Invest. You know what this is for me coming here? It's an investment. I sow the seed of my ministry into the rich soil of your mind because I judge you to be fertile ground. Your potentials are limitless. Who knows what you will be and what you will do? I've seen many men come out of prison and run straight to my church. They're in our church, in our ministry right now. standing around me with a loyalty that I couldn't buy because of an investment. I got people working on staff who were homeless, living up on the bridges, and now they're part of our ministry. You wouldn't know they were homeless. You wouldn't know they were ex-felons. They're all dressed up, smelling good, looking good, got a haircut, got a bad tie on, looking all important. But up under all of that is Slick Willie, Dirty Danny, Freakin' Freddy, and Jumpin' Jimmy. And it's all good. Everybody else can, you know, they can pastor the high and mighty. I just take whoever God sends. All colors, all cultures, all kinds. It makes no difference. Doesn't make any difference at all. Makes no difference. Whenever real trouble comes, all racial lines blur in a war. Men who went to Vietnam, they went in prejudice. They came back talking about Jimmy got a picture of this black man on the wall. Because in combat, you don't care what color he is. You just want him to cover your hind end. And they might come back and talk all prejudice. Ain't none of them no good except for Jimmy. Jimmy's all right. Yeah, Jimmy kept a bullet out of my behind. Yeah, so Jimmy is all right. We're in a war. It's a spiritual war. We're not fighting with bullets and guns, but we're fighting a spiritual warfare. And so anybody who covers me, it doesn't make any difference what color, what kind, or where they came from. Just cover me because I'm in the foxhole. How about you? Find some brothers who will cover you. Enter into covenant, and I make this investment into your life, into your future, because perhaps had more significant investments been made earlier, perhaps you'd have never passed this way. Who knows? Who knows? That's what I believe. You ready to go to Word?
Yeah.
Let's get in the Word of God. Go to Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2, verse number 1. When I left off yesterday, talking about Christ who proved his power, the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him far above principalities and powers and dominions and all might, and established him to be the head of the church, which filleth all in all. He is the head of the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. And then we drop down to Ephesians 2 and 1. Only in 2 and 1, it's not talking about Christ raising himself from the dead, but now it's talking about the same Christ who raised himself from the dead now raises you from the dead. He said, and you hath he quickened. In the King James, it says, and you hath he quickened. In many other translations, it says, and you hath he made alive. The word quicken means to be made alive. And you hath he quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. Dead in sin. And I was thinking last night, because I went to bed thinking about you and how to communicate the word to you in such a way that it's meaningful. You hath he quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. There is being dead in sin, which is what you were before you got saved. You were dead in sin, actually slain by sin. Sin killed you, dead in sin. And then in Romans 6, it talks about being dead to sin. Once you become born again, you become dead to sin. Sin is not dead to you, but you are dead to it. And when you die out to it, it no longer has power over you. In Romans 6, it talks about he that is dead is freed from sin. And what it basically talks about, sin will always exist. It never changes. It will never go away. But you have to become dead to it. It will never change. Sin is old. Sin is old. When you finally plop over in somebody's grave, sin will still be standing there. It ain't changed. You haven't created nothing new. It was there when you got here. It's going to be there when you're gone. You'll never get enough of it. You'll never kill it. You'll never destroy it. You will never kill it. It will kill you. it will kill you. And so what has to happen is you have to become dead to it. See, I tell my wife, I said, when I die, don't be sitting around with a bunch of my pictures all over the house. Loving my pictures and stuff, because my pictures can't hold you at night, and my pictures can't comfort you, and I can't do you no good. It would be just as silly as keeping the corpse in the living room. I grew up, my people came from Mississippi and Alabama, and whenever they had funerals in the South, they bring the corpse to the house. I thought that was the dumbest thing I ever saw in my life. I couldn't even sleep. My grandmama was in the living room, I was scared to death. My mama said, she love you. I wish she loved me from somewhere else, because I was about 7 years old, and grandmama was in the living room laid out, and then they had that music playing, and Haley Jackson was singing, the light was on, and I had to sleep in her bed. Boy, I thought to myself, suppose she don't want me in her bed. All night long, I had one eye open. You know, I didn't want to offend grandma, because see, nobody wants to keep, no matter how much you love somebody, when you're dead, you know, bye. Yeah, because, you know, no matter how much you love me, you don't want to keep nobody till they stinking and laid up and all that kind of stuff. I used to get rid of all my stuff, going with your life. Just marry somebody if you want to get married. You know, marry somebody intelligent. Marry somebody that's not going to waste what I live for, so I don't have to come back and haunt them or nothing. But just you see, because no matter if she bring me in there and roll me in the house, she can put on my favorite negligee, but it won't affect me because I'm dead to her. She can cook my best meal, but it won't do me no good because I'm dead to her. She can whisper in my ear and say all the stuff that I really want to hear, but I will give her no reaction because I'm dead to her. When the Bible talks about being dead to sin, sin might still flaunt itself. It still might be flagrant in your life, but once you're dead to it, you no longer react to it anymore. Yeah, even when I wander, I'm going somewhere. Just, you know, Paul said, when I was a child, I thought as a child, I spake as a child and understood as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. That's how you know you're a man, when you can put away childish things. When you can put it away from you, that no longer has control over you. Okay, it still exists. It still flaunts itself. It still moves about, even offering you things that you did enjoy, and you cannot deny that you did enjoy it. But you come to a point that you're ready to put away childish things. Put away childish things. If you don't grow up now, when? What else would it take? What would you go through that would cause you to wake up if not now? This is the moment. If you miss this moment, you've lost it all. And you have it quickened quickly, quickened, suddenly, made alive in a flash. That's how revelation comes into your spirit, just that quick. And you had the quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. Dead in the trespasses of sin. Dead in it. Dead, not dead to it, dead in it. Dead to it is when I get saved. I get saved, now I'm dead to it. It's still around, but it don't bother me anymore. See, they still got mescaline out there, but it don't bother her no more. You see what I'm saying? This dead to it. Just don't have no interest in it anymore. And so that's a development state. You are the quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. Now, I'm kind of torn because there's some things I want to show you. Let me do it this way. I'm not sure you're going to be able to see this, but I'm going to try. let me try this. That's nice, but it don't work for me. Now, that may not look like you, but that's a picture of you. You see why I didn't major in art. It is a picture of you. Those of you that can't see, but you can hear me teaching over systems, I've got three circles, a big one and a middle-sized one inside of the big one and a small one inside of it. The smallest circle represents the spirit of a man. The middle circle and the space between represents the soulish realm. The outer circle represents the body. This is a picture of you. This is all that you are. Triune. Like God, a body, a soul, and a spirit. That's all that you are. Three different parts of you. Three significant parts of you. In fact, I want to define each part. In essence, you are a spirit. You have a soul, and you live in a body. Okay? This is real important, because if you understand this, this will really help you with life. You are a spirit. I am not a body. I have a body, but I'm not my body. That's why you could cut my leg off and I'd still be me. I could lose both legs. I could lose my arms and be paraplegic. I have lost most of my body and still have not lost any of me, because I am not a body. I have a body, but I am not a body. In fact, I am a spirit. And when I lose my spirit, my body means nothing at all. I am a spirit like God. God is a spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. If God, who is a spirit, created a man and called him a son, then the son he created must be like the daddy who made him. See, all of my children, I have five of them, all of them are African American. I have no Chinese children. I'm not against Chinese people. It's just that I could not produce a Chinese child from an African loins. The child didn't get to vote what race it would be. He became what I shot into her. He was born black like his daddy. God is a spirit. When God got ready to reproduce himself, he reproduced himself with what he had, and his son became like him. Whether you're talking about Jesus or Adam, Adam was his first created son, you know. Jesus was his only begotten son. The Bible says Israel was his firstborn son. And a son is going to be like his daddy. God is a spirit. All right. And so when God created Adam, he created him a spirit and blew that spirit into flesh. He blew spirit, pneuma in the Greek, pneuma, air. He blew spirit. The same word that is translated spirit is translated air. He blew spirit into man. That's all you are, a spirit. When that stops, you gone. I held my mother. I was there wrapped around the bed with my mother, my brother, and my sister when she passed away. My mother went, and all that she had slipped out of my arms. Still holding her body, but my mama was gone. You know why? My mama was not a body. We buried her body, but not my mama. Because my mama is a spirit. And I saw her spirit go from her and she was gone. I am a spirit. Like God, he breathed into Adam the breath of life and he became a living soul. Hebrew word nephesh, he became a living soul. God breathed in him the breath of life and he became like his daddy, a spirit who lived in a body. And the fact that the spirit lived in the body gave him a soul. Watch this, can I teach you something? Okay. In my body, I have world consciousness. It is only because of my body that I know that I'm in the world. The only reason I knew it was hot last night is because I had a body. If I had lost my body and died, it wouldn't have been hot. Dead people don't get hot. They don't get cold. Flies light on their nose, they don't scratch. Because their body is the only thing that gives you world consciousness. When your body dies, you lose world consciousness. Are you following what I'm saying? In my spirit, I have God consciousness. It's in the spirit that I come to know God. I know God in my spirit. I know God in my spirit, or I don't know him at all. I know God in my spirit. The spirit is the essence of me. It is the root of me. It's all that I really am, is a spirit. In fact, gentlemen, I want to tell you that your body can be incarcerated, but not your spirit. You must understand that John was on the Isle of Patmos. He was in a grotto. It was a cave. He was on there with felons and convicts. He was locked up with the inmates. That's where his body was. But he wrote the book of Revelations while he was in the pen. And he says, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. They had him chained to a cave. And he writes, I was in the spirit. His body was in the cave. But in the spirit, he was free. Not only was he free to move, he wrote the book of Revelations while he was in prison. Because they could not imprison his spirit. In my spirit, I have God consciousness. In my soul, I have self-consciousness. It's in my soulish realm. In my soul, I have self-consciousness. In my spirit, I have God consciousness. In my soul, I have self-consciousness. In my body, I have world consciousness. My soulish realm is my self-consciousness. In this realm, this second dimension, lives my mind, my memories, my affections. All exist in my soulish realm. All of that exists in my soulish realm. When I was in sin, my spirit was dead. God consciousness, dead. My spirit was dead. My body was alive. Every passion, every sensation, every lust, alive. Not only alive, but heightened. I had nothing else to live for but the feeling of the moment. That's all I had. My spirit was dead. My soul was bruised. My mind bruised, my memories bruised, my affections bruised by what I've been through, what I came from, what happened to me. My soul bruised, dwarfed, stuck in a perpetual childhood state. Dwarfed, a big man with little boy issues. Dwarfed, wounded, bruised by the impact of the pain of my childhood. I was left hurting in my soulish realm. And out of that confusion comes anger, hostility, envy, and pettiness. All came as a result of the bruises in my soul. Are you following me? Now watch this. What happens to me, thank you, I'll probably break every piece on here before I finish. I've always been heavy-handed. But okay, what happens to me is my spirit is dead. So it's not that I didn't have respect for God, because I was raised to have respect for God, but I didn't have consciousness, God consciousness. There was no sensitivity of his awareness or his real presence or his impact in my life, and I could not relate to people who really took him that seriously because my spirit was dead. I took seriously what my body could feel. I took seriously what I could touch, taste, smell, hear. All of my senses, where we get the word sensual, all of that has to do with your body. What I can touch, what I can taste, what I can smell, what I can hear, my senses, my body. And I approached everything according to what my body wanted, my body got. My body, it feels good. Oh, it feels good. I had nothing to counteract that because my spirit was dead. When Christ comes into your life, he reverses this process and brings life to your spirit. And you have he quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. And all of a sudden, the part of you that was dead comes to life. So that the part of you that was alive could be put to death. All of a sudden, my flesh begins to be crucified. Crucified. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself a ransom for me. So when Christ comes into my life and you have the quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin, he quickens the part of me that was dead and crucifies the part of me that was alive. And the whole process is reversed. And all of a sudden, the part of me that I am begins to live. And the part of me that I live in, which is my body, begins to die. Is it dead yet? No, not totally. I am crucified. Crucified is not like being shot. It's a slow death. It's an agonizing death. It's being torn between, come on, bro. Come right on up. Thank you. Good. I'm gonna go through all of that. It's It's a process of change and transformation that is very significant. And you have he quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin. This is a picture of you. This is all you will ever be. A wheel in the middle of a wheel in the, isn't that what they said God was? A wheel in the middle of a wheel. That's what God is. And when God spoke out on the midst of nothing and said, let there be, he spoke circles. He spoke circles. He spoke circles. Moons, suns, solar systems. Everything started spinning in circles. Circles. Whenever they give you a circle, who's got a wedding ring? Do you have a wedding ring? Somebody, give me a wedding ring. 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 You know what? You ate too much. Now, you know what? This is a wedding ring. You know what it is? The reason we give wedding rings, the reason that they are round and the reason that we give wedding rings is because it is a symbol of eternal love. It means, this circle means endless love. Not a line, not a triangle, but a circle. Eternity. Endless circles. Your God is a circle. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. And when he spoke and said, let there be, all of the solar system started spinning in circles. The sun started spinning in circles. The circle, the spinning of the sun caused gravity, and all the earth began to rotate, and all the planets began to go around in circles because he, which is a circle, spoke a circle. So when I say this is a picture of you, it's not just that I don't draw well, though I don't. Is that your existence is a circle. When Christians talk about eternal life, it's not always a good picture if you don't understand what eternal life means. Because the real truth of the matter is, all of us will continue to live eternally. An eternal God can only produce an eternal offspring. Even science teaches that everything that did exist will exist in another form. That all matter can do is change its molecular structure, but it continues to exist in another form. If I set this podium on fire, it will cease to exist in this form, but it will continue to exist in another form. The ashes will go down to the ground and finally mix into the soil. The smoke will carry other parts of it up into the atmosphere, but it will continue to exist in another form. When the Bible talks about eternal life, it's not just talking about the longevity of life. It's not just talking about that you're going to live, but where you're going to live. When Jesus says, I come that you might have life and have it more abundantly, he didn't come that you might have existence, because you are going to exist eternally anyway. He came that you might exist in the presence of God. For when the Bible defines life, the opiate of life, the optimum capacity of life, is not continued existence, but existence where? With God. When Ephesians 2 and 1 says, and you have the quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin, it means that he stepped into your life and he brought back to life the part of you that was dead. Now, this is a challenging thing. Let me show you something. Are y'all with me? Oh, this is good. This is good. This is good. See? Now, look at Ephesians 2, 2. Wherein in times past you walked, all of this is a result of being dead in sin. Wherein in times past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, whatever was disobedient, you was into it. You walked according to the prince of the power of this air, which is Satan. You did whatever the world was doing, you walked in accordance. Oh, you're with me. You walked according to the course of this world. Verse 3, among whom also we had our conversations in times past. Conversations means lifestyles. We had a lifestyle that centered around the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, both realms all messed up, and were by nature, it was natural to be the children of wrath, even as others. But God, That's the turning point. Everything in this text spirals down. And you had the quickened who were dead in the trespasses of sin, where in times past you walked according to the God of this world, according to the prince of this world, according to the spirit of disobedience. All of it's going down and down. And you walked according to the nature, the lusts of your flesh and of your mind, even as others. And all is on its way down, going down, 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 to verse 4. When it gets to verse 4, it stops and says, but God. But God, who is rich in mercy, wherein he have loved us. It is that but God, the word but, that conjunction but puts a stop to the spiraling down and starts you on a recourse where you begin to spiral back up again. And the whole rest of the text is raising you up to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. It's raising you up from where you were spiraling down. And it all starts with the fourth verse when it says, but God. Are you following what I'm saying? I would have went completely down, but God. I would have committed suicide and died, but God. I would have lost my mind and threw in the towel, but God. He stopped the spiraling down in my life and began to spin me back up again. Now I aspire to be like God. Because he begins to start, aspire, spiral up, spiral up, aspire. Aspire. I'm going up. And I begin to start the spiraling motion of coming up out of what I was spiraling down into. Are you following what I'm saying? Now, let me show you some. Verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, wherein he loved us, even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us, made us alive, together with Christ, by grace ye are saved. And look at us going up, and have raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might shew the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. You are his masterpiece. You, my brother, and the mess you are into are the canvas that he paints on. You're the lumber that he constructs with. He takes your raw resources and builds something out of the ashes of your dilemma. You, he takes subordinate materials and makes masterpieces, so that when people look at you spiraling up, there will be no question as to how you became a wonderful workmanship. It was not the material that he had to work with, but the master's hand. It is his hand that causes you to be exceptional, not your material. You see, a real master at his craft can take less and do more with it. If you're really a master, you don't have to have much to work with. When I went to Africa, they were taking sticks and carving, little sharp sticks, and carving out of trees giraffes and painting them with sticks, just little pieces of stick, look very not much bigger than a toothpick, or it looked like what the chopsticks that the Chinese eat, with about that wide, a quarter of an inch wide, and they take it and dip it in paint, and they paint the spots perfectly with a stick. You know what that means? That means that Joker is a master at his craft. Because I would have to have a template, and I'd have to put a template with all the holes matching, and then I'd just take a big old Sears paintbrush and slap him and pull it back and say, ta-da. Oh, I'd get it done, but I had to do it another way. But he was so steady with his hand that he could paint the giraffe with a stick. Now you know you have a master, when you can take cheap stuff and produce masterpieces. Well, the Bible said that we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus on the good works. He took stuff that other people rejected and made masterpieces, because God wants to show off on you. He wants to take the very one that everybody said would never be nothing and say, look at how bad I am.
I can do it with Willie. And when they see the transformation of your twisted soul, they will know that a master has been working on you and not a rookie. Now, I'm going to flip you around a little bit and take you 5 to the 5th chapter, because I want to keep this going. Did you see my illustration? Did you see my illustration with the 3 circles, body, soul, and spirit? Put it back up there for me. Just the body, soul, and spirit in the 3 circles. Okay. Now, here's my challenge. I got like, in my series, in my books, I got like maybe, you got it? Oh, you do good. That's all right, you're making me look bad, I'll do it. I want an old ugly circle like what I had. Don't be writing all good and stuff either. Okay. Now, listen, here's my challenge with you. Because in my series, I talk about the wealth of the believer, the walk of the believer. Y'all come back to me. I know I'm not pretty, but look at me. They done left me. I'm teaching my heart out. You go sit down. This ain't working. I lost the whole class. I've been preaching for 23 years. I never have lost the entire audience. I mean, nobody. Reese, I'm gonna use you. I still might lose some of y'all with Reese. I don't know what I'm gonna do. Look. Stay with me. It's gonna be all right. Okay. Boy, prison ministry's tough. Now, I lost everybody. I have never lost everybody. Y'all know how to kill my self-esteem. I forgot what I was saying and everything. I feel you, okay? Okay, we're gonna make it through this, okay? Here's the challenge. I noticed something. Whenever I go any place to minister, I walk in a place, I feel the room. I feel the room, I feel the atmosphere. It's important to me that I be in on the worship service, because it's in the worship service that I get to evaluate and understand where you are. I need to feel it so that I can do what I do, because it's my job to take you where you've never been. And in order to do that, I have to assess where you are. Let me tell you understand what I'm saying? Okay. And so when I go back to my room, I begin to say, well now, Lord, where are they and where do I need to take them? Here's the challenge. Okay, there's some things about God that you understand. You understand your need of him. Mm-hmm. You understand your need of him. You have a respect for him, an appreciation for him, a love for him, and a love for people who love him. I can feel that immediately. You understand that you're supposed to praise him. You're excited to praise God. But there's another realm beyond praise called worship. And somewhere between praise and worship, you're not making a transfer. And there are several challenges to praise and worship. And I need to teach them to you before I leave. I'm getting a ringing a little bit. Okay, and then probably because I'm moving all over the place. But okay, let me tell you a few things about praise. Whenever we praise God, we tend to do it with our bodies. We praise with our bodies. We lift our hands. We clap our hands. You got that part down pat. You stomp your feet. You do body praise well. You do praise with your mouth. You open your mouth. Hallelujah. Come on with it. Thank you, Lord. Verbal things is praise. Used to operating with your body. You took your body that you were using one way, switched them to the other, and now you approach God physically. Praise is good. But praise is just the preliminary of a real relationship with God. The deeper relationship with God comes from going beyond praising Him with your body into worshiping God in your spirit. Okay? When you start worshiping God in your spirit, there is a level of intimacy that is so much deeper. Now, I got a lot of challenges in getting you into worship. First of all, one of the first challenges is your gender. Because as men, we are trained all of our lives not to open up. Just do not open. Physically, I'm built closed. I'm not like the woman, she's built open. I'm built closed. And if that were not enough, I'm trained to be closed. 3 years old crying, they said, be a man, don't cry. So masculinity has been inherently taught to me that real masculinity doesn't cry. So all of a sudden, when I get out in life and I come to the woman who is open and she asks me for intimacy, I give her lots of sex. Because it is easier for me to give sex and stay closed than it is for me to give intimacy and be open. Because when she asks me to open up my feelings, it terrifies me. So I give her more body. And as soon as she gets used to whatever I'm giving her with body, she gets tired of it and wants me. So I go to work and give her money. Because I will pay her not to open me up. Because I am afraid of myself. Because it's hard to be tough, open. And I don't know what weakness, frailty, softness you might see. So I protect myself by staying close. That's my natural masculine inclination, to suck it up and shut up. But when I get up under enough pressure and pain, I become a bomb ticking, about to explode because I cannot open up. I have all the feelings she does, but I don't have the permission to express them. And all of a sudden, I am having heart attacks at early ages, dying 10 years younger than she does because I cannot release how I feel. When my wife comes home upset, she can fall apart and cry. She can fall into my... And I can just go right in. In fact, I enjoy it. I can go right into, oh, baby, you know. I got you, girl. What you talking about? Wipe your face, girl. You know I got you. But what she doesn't know is that sometimes I come home and I want to fall apart too. I feel just like she does. But I don't know what to do with it. What do you do with what you feel when you've never been allowed to express it? So my first challenge in teaching you worship is your gender. Has already trained you, some of you 30, 40, 50 years, to stay closed. Now add to that, you're in a prison. Now you become more tight than Manhattan Chase Bank. Because you survive by closing down. You survive being incarcerated by just going dead. Because you really don't want to deal with your feelings. So you deny them. Like a child, you get afraid. You run up under the bed and you think that if you cover up your head, whatever you saw in the room will go away. So you hide who you are. This is not new. It's as old as Adam. When Adam sinned, the first thing he did was hide himself. Now, how can you hide yourself from yourself? And then come to a God whose inclination is to strip you down and say, I want you. And you're trying to do the same thing with God that you did with women. You give him body. So you come to a God who is a spirit, and all you give him week after week and service after service is your body. You clap your hands in his face, you stomp your feet, you give him everything but you. And you wonder why you are not fulfilled spiritually. How can you be fulfilled spiritually when all you do is give him body? Now you find yourself in a dilemma because you survive by silence. You endure by locking up. You come in here and you find the system and you succumb to the system and you blend into the woodwork and you survive because you have rocked your emotions to sleep and you don't want to open up who you are because who you are is not as tough as who you pretend to be. And everybody knows it in the whole facility, but nobody says nothing about it. Because we must keep this lie alive. We must be tough. We must be indifferent. How else will we make it? So even when you come to God, you come in covered up, which is as dumb as going to a physician and keeping your suit on. How can he examine what you will not expose? How can he heal what you will not show? So you have given God praise, praise. Praise talks about God. Praise speaks well of God. Praise eulogizes God. The word eulogy means to speak well of. That's what we do at funerals. We speak well of the deceased. It's really praise. We eulogize God. We speak well of him. And we speak well, oh, he's a good God. And we start talking all of this Christian rhetoric. But I notice the moment we get ready to switch from praise, which is a lot of yaddy, into worship, which means your heart has to open up, you stop clapping and sit down. And it is the mistake of Israel. God said to Israel, with your lips you draw nigh unto me, but with your heart you are far from me. And the real dilemma that I have, and the reason I have to cut to the chase, is that I only have two more sessions to be with you, and I'm going to leave you in a system that if you don't learn how to worship, you will not be able to medicate your own pain. And anytime you cannot medicate your own pain, you will always reach to other men and other systems and other arms and other drugs and other kind of everything that exists in here, and I know it, to medicate what you cannot confront, which makes your faith not work for you. Because you are trying to give God sex and he wants intimacy. Now, look at this word. Ephesians 5:18. It says, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Bring me an empty cup and a filled cup of anything. Makes no difference. Anything. Okay. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. In fact, bring me two empty cups and one filled cup, and I may need another filled cup. I'm making this up as I go, but it's going to be good. Now, you're good, 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 good. Now, let me show you something. I want to feel this. What is this? Tea? I want to feel this cup. I got tea on it, but I don't have no tea in it. It's on it, but it's not in it. Oh, because the cup isn't opened up. And in order for me to get anything in it where it can be filled, I have to expose the part that opens up. Because God is not satisfied to be on you. Procreation begins by being in you. Now, the only way for God to get in you is for you to open up. Be not drunk with wine. See, if you don't open up to God, you're going to open up to something else. So you start opening up to everything else but God. And when it comes to God, you shut down. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Slow, slow. Stop. Every time you open up to God, He fills you a little bit more with His Spirit. Every time you open up your vulnerabilities, He fills you. Stop.
Right.
Some of you are walking around like this. You got just enough Spirit to be religious, but not enough to be filled. And I don't have to stay in the prison to know you. I can watch you worship and tell where you're at. Let me tell you what I know. I know you're glad I'm here. I know you are excited. But the problem with that is I am leaving. So if all you get excited about is me, by tonight you will be back where you were. I appreciate your warm welcome. I really do. It helps me so much. It means a lot to me. But in order for me to get on the plane and feel good about being here, I must do more than know that you received me. I want to see you receive this. Show you something. when Paul starts talking about this, and it's so incredible, because I told you the other day that Paul is incredibly intelligent. He's articulate. He's astute. And what I didn't tell you is that we used to sing, I've been in church a long time now, and we used to sing the old gospel songs, used to say, I may not be able to sing like the angels, and I may not be able to preach like Paul, but I can tell the love of Jesus and how he saved my soul, and all the songs had in it. But let me tell you something. I don't think that Paul was a great preacher. I don't think that Paul was a great preacher, because one time Paul was preaching, and a guy fell so asleep that he fell out the window and broke his neck. Anytime you preach so bad that somebody falls out a window and breaks their neck, you can't preach. I might lose one or two of you, but if I'm any good at what I do, I'm not supposed to have y'all falling out the window breaking your neck. It's one thing for you to drop your head, but when your whole body falls out the window and you die, I mean, that message will just flunk. But while he might not have been exciting when he preached, when he wrote, he was a master. Paul could turn an entire city upside down with a letter. He wrote like a master, and we are still deciphering the letters of an inmate. That's what your Bible is filled with. And when he writes this letter, I respect him as a writer too much to read this text and not wonder the inconsistency. Watch this, watch this. He says, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, verse 18, but be filled with the Spirit, verse 19. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself, for no man ever yet hateth his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church, for we are members of his body and of his flesh and of his bone. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and shall be joined unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Wait a minute, Paul, you're a great writer, but you keep switching subjects. No great writer, I've written 20 some books, believe me when I tell you, no great writer flips the script in the middle of the chapter. Now, either this is somebody who really can't write, or there is a mystery. For he starts out talking to me about worship, speaking to yourselves, making melody in your heart unto the Lord, singing spiritual songs are songs that are birthed out of the Spirit. Hymns unto God, hymns, interesting word. Hymn, same word where we get hymen. Hymn, a hymn breaks the wall of flesh and takes you into the inner sanctum, into the place where procreation becomes appropriate. A hymn takes you from the outer court to the holies of holies. A hymn takes you out of your flesh into the Spirit. Oh my goodness. And right in the middle of him teaching about worship, speaking to yourself, making melody in your heart, gentlemen, your spirit unto the Lord. In the middle of him talking about that, all of a sudden he takes off on this tangent about marriage. What in the world does marriage have to do with worship? He starts talking about how you ought to nourish the woman as your own body and as your own flesh, and whosoever loveth his wife loveth himself. And he starts going on this tangent about submitting yourselves to one another, and it talks about, for this cause shall a man leave his mother and father, take unto him a wife, and they shall cleave. The word cleave literally means to tackle. He shall tackle her, and they shall become one flesh. Oh God, this is some heavy duty stuff going on. all this tackling and paraphernalia going on. It's pretty tough stuff. And it makes my head boomerang because I was following him through worship, and now he's gone to the intimacy of a sexual relationship between a man and his wife in the same chapter. Now, either he is an idiot, which I already know he is not, or there is a revelation. There is a revelation. And I want to touch on it with you. For you see, when you worship God, you make love in the spirit. When you worship God, you give intimacy to the Creator. When you worship God, you open your heart and He comes in and dwells in the innermost part of you. Worship is far deeper than praise. Psalms 150 says, let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Anybody can praise God. But the Gospel of St. John chapter 4 says, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, and the Father seeketh such to worship him. So everybody can't worship. Anybody can praise. Even an old, rank, drunk, whoremongering sinner can praise God if he's breathing. Let everything that have breath, a blue jay can praise God, a monkey can praise God, a giraffe, everything that have breath, anything that's breathing can praise God. But when it comes to worship, the Father seeketh somebody to worship him. Worship separates the men from the boys. Because in order to worship, you must open up your heart like a woman opens up her body, and he comes into your heart and dwells with you and gives you peace and the comfort that we give to them, we need from him. And so we go to him and say, here I am. I open my heart and I become vulnerable to you. And our relationship satisfies me because I am a worshiper. God wants in. Now, I don't know how serious you are about him. I don't know whether you're here because you're nice enough to come, or you're here because you just appreciate somebody paying you some attention. But I will assume that you are here because you are hungry to know more about him. And I refuse to leave here having given you me when I have an opportunity to give you him. Amen. He will stay with you when everybody leaves, but you can't just give him somebody, and you can't just give him an offering and pay him to leave you alone like he is your woman, because he wants in your heart, the very place you've trained yourself to hide. Is where your God wants to live. He wants you to open your heart in worship until you have the intimacy in him that you cannot find in anybody else. And he satisfies and gives you peace as you open your heart in his presence. When I walk in a room and begin to worship, I can immediately tell the depth of the room by the magnitude of the worship. If real worship hits this place, you'll go so far into it that you can't come out. If real worship comes into this place, it will overwhelm you till you act like a drunk man. No wonder Paul says, be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit, because real worship is intoxicating. And if I were where you were, I would want worship. I
I would want to get so drunk in the spirit that I ceased to be in San Quentin. I would want to be in my cell and leave the cell though my body was in the room. I would want to get so lost in the glory of God that my heart didn't ache and my mind didn't break. I would want to get so deep in the presence of God that he touched the parts of me that had been hurting all of my life and that he gave me peace like I had never had before. I wouldn't be satisfied to just get around the brothers who go to church and talk to them about God, but I'd want to speak to myself till I got myself off, got way over in the presence of God, and was able to minister to myself at 2 o'clock in the morning. While everybody was sleeping, the chapel was locked up. I'd build my own chapel and I'd have church in my bed. I'd lay on my cot and get drunk in the spirit and I'd talk to him because my life is so in his hands that if he doesn't help me, I'll have no help at all. I'd want to be so close to him that I left out of my body and out of my situation, and I would want his spirit to make me so drunk that I had a joy unspeakable. Now you need to understand, I'm not impressed with drugs. Been there, done that. I was running drugs for my brother in junior high school in the 7th grade. I was playing with mescaline when I was in the 7th grade. I have been as high as anybody wants to be in here. Tried a little bit of everything, but I have never been as drunk as I have been in the Holy Ghost. Never, never in all of my life, if you open your heart to God and stop just giving him body, he would come into your pain and give you peace. And your salvation will never work for you until you worship. How do you worship? It's what the women always told us, and we never wanted to do it. You know how the women always tell you, baby, we need to talk, and you don't want to talk? I'd rather do anything less not talk. Let's make love. Let's build a house. Let's paint the refrigerator. Let's not talk. The woman was right, because talking makes you open up, and it releases intimacy. Intimacy. Into me, see. That's what intimacy is. See into me. Here I am. Not the macho me, not the me that prison made me have to be. See into me, into my fear, into my tears, into my disappointment, into my pain. God, after hiding from everybody else and even hiding from myself, don't let me get here and hide from you. Adam, where art thou? Where art thou? Here I am. Here I am, Lord. Here I am. You found me. I'm coming out of the closet. This is me. See into the child in me. See into the pain of me. See into the fear of me. See into me.
I'm tired of going through the motions of Christianity. I need a personal Savior. Hold me in your arms at night. Rock me to sleep like the child I am. Kiss my tears away and renew my strength, because I need you like I never needed you before. And I don't want to fake you out with the symbols of faith and the movings and the clappings and the mediocrity of faith. Into me, see. Everything's not pretty and everything's not right. Into me, see. I've been here so long that I'm not sure that I could make it if I came out. Into me, see. I'm afraid I won't get out, and I'm afraid I will. Into me, see. I'm confused between the relationships out there and the relationships in here. Into me, see. Into my freakishness. Into my pain. Into my anger. Into my confusion. I'm sorry I hid from you. You're the only doctor I have left. And why am I in your office and I've still got on a suit? Strip myself before you. Come on in to me. Give me the peace I cannot find. I'm so desperate for love, I'm looking for it anywhere I can find it. But all I get is sex. And for the level of my pain, it doth not satisfy. See into me. That's what worship is. If you ever decide to do it, you have to strip yourself open. And if real worship hits its place, there'll be some men on their knees, and some men standing, and some men weeping, and some men walking. And nobody will have to say anything, because it won't be about who's talking. It'll be about a God who's listening. Worship begins when you open your heart and you begin to talk to Him. I bless you, Lord. I need you, Lord. I bless your name. I honor you. You, Lord, I come to you. I need you. I need you. I need you. Lord, Lord, Lord. You're my key, you're my peace, you're my everything. You, Jesus, I need you. Calm my fears, dry my tears, I need you. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood will shed for me. Let thy bidness may come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Should have been sooner, but I come. Should have been younger, Lamb of God, I come. Thank you for being with me. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for holding me. Never been held before. I never ever been held before. Hold me, Jesus. Hold me. Hold me, Jesus. Hold me. In the middle of the night, hold me. Hold me. I'm not afraid to tell you. I'm not afraid to tell you I need you. I am weak, but thou art strong. Father, keep me from all wrong, Lord Jesus. I need you. Don't leave me. I don't want to be alone. I'm tired of being on my own.
Jill, stay with me. Daddy, would you stay with me tonight? Daddy, would you stay with me tonight? Daddy, Daddy, would you stay with me? Stay with me tonight. I worship you. You're my king. You're my everything. I worship you. You're my king. You're my everything. I worship you. You're my king. You're my everything. Don't leave me, Jesus. Don't leave me, Lord. Don't leave me. Don't leave me. Stay with me. Stay the night. Till the morning light. Stay the night. Stay the night. Till the morning light. Jesus, stay with me. I need you. Mama's gone. My fear is on. Stay with me. Just as I am without one plea, Lord, your blood was shed for wretches like me. Oh, Lord, I come to you. I come to you. I ain't got nothing else to do. I come to you. Oh, Lamb of God, I come. I want you to lift your hands in his presence. Lift your hands.
I worship you.
I want you to open your mouth. And whatever you feel for God, just start saying it out of your mouth.
I worship you, King of Kings. I worship you. I worship you.
Talk to him. Break the silence. Break the silence. Open your mouth and praise.
You're my family. You're my friend. You stick with me to the end. Lord Jesus, I worship you. I worship you. I worship you. I take wing of the morning and I fly away. Spread your wings, brother, and fly away. Fly away, my brother, fly away. In the arms of your King. Oh, if I had wings, I'd fly away. Spread your wings and fly away. Spread your wings and fly away. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody help me worship the King of Kings. Somebody help me worship the King.
Feel the glory about to fall in this place. Somebody worship him. Oh, oh, somebody worship him. I need some gods that will worship him. I need some staff that will worship him. Somebody worship him. He don't care who you are. He don't care what you do. Somebody worship him. Worship him.
worship him, worship him, worship him, worship him, worship him. I feel his glory about to come in here now. Worship him. Oh, worship him. Get intimate with God and worship him. Here's my wound, here's my scar, here's my problem. Oh God, I want to worship him. I worship him. I worship you. I ain't got nothing left to do but worship you. I ain't got nothing else to do but worship you. Lord, I worship you. With my whole heart, I worship you. With my heart, I worship you. Can you find your heart, brother? With my whole heart, I worship you. Reach down through the trash, the pain, the muck in the mouth. With my heart, Lord, I worship you. I make melody in my heart to the King of Kings. Oh, Lord, I make melody in my heart to the King of Kings. Have you still got a song in your heart? Get it out and worship him. Get it out and worship him. Get it out and worship him. Hallelujah. If your body can't leave, your heart can leave. If your body can't leave, your heart can leave. Get your heart out and worship him. Everywhere you can hear me, get your heart out and worship him. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his wonderful works toward the children of men. I bless you, Lord. Oh, Jesus, I worship you. 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 Oh. I worship you. Open your mouth and worship him. Open your mouth and worship him. You've been closed too long. Open your mouth, open your mouth, open your mouth, open your mouth, open your mouth and worship him. Open your mouth and worship him. Your time bomb ticking. Open your mouth and worship him. If I don't worship him, 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 I got to worship him. I got to. Let me worship him. Let me worship him. I got to worship him. I worship you, Lord. I worship you. My cup, I lift it up. Fill my cup, I lift it up to you, Jesus. Quench the thirsting of my soul. I worship him. I worship him. I worship him. I worship him. Show me how to open up. I hear somebody saying, show me how to open up. I've been closed so long. Show me how to open up. I'd be in prison if I wasn't in prison. Show me how to open up. All my doors are closed and all my windows are shut. Show me how to worship him. Hallelujah. If you stay in a prison, you're gonna stay in a prison. Open your heart and fly away. Show me how to worship him. Show me how to worship him. Hallelujah. Bow down and worship him. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. He's still worthy. He's still worthy. You could have been dead. He's still worthy. He's worthy. If I had the wings of the morning, I'd fly away and be at rest. I'll fly away and be at rest. He's worthy to be praised. 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 Hallelujah.
Come and sing, bow down and worship him. Lift your hands up and just begin to worship him. Just worship him. Just lift your hands. We don't have nothing else to do. We worship you.
Bow down and worship. Bow down and worship him.
help you. You need to.
Join hands with somebody. Squeeze that hand you're holding. You're holding a miracle in your hands. You're holding somebody who could have been dead. There's life in that body. That's a miracle. You're holding somebody who thought they would never be able to take what they've taken. That's a miracle. Squeeze that hand. That's how close you are to your next miracle. Open your heart up to God and let Him touch the real you. Let Him touch the real you. Let His presence abide in your heart. You are brothers.
in chains, in pain, in the storm, and in the rain. He's here right now to touch you and to see you through. He's tired of you just giving him lip service. He wants your heart. Give it to him. I want you to pray for the man whose hand you're holding. I want you to pray for him. Pray for him in the day. Pray for him in the night. Pray for him when nobody's looking. Pray for the little boy in him. Pray for the pain and the fear and the stress in him. Pray for the people who love him, the people who write him. Pray for the people who left him. Pray for the people who forgot him and he can't forget them. Pray for his memories. Pray for his mind. Squeeze his hand. Pray for his nightmares. Hallelujah. Pray that the Lamb of God would just come and touch and heal and deliver him. That holy Lamb. That marvelous Lamb who shed his blood 2,000 years ago for people like us. The Lamb that can wash you in the blood until you're white as snow. That's who's going to keep you and strengthen you and see you through. Hallelujah. When people are gone, when I'm gone, when everybody's gone, he'll be there for you. Open your heart to him. Oh, Holy Lamb, we bless you and we honor you today. And we give you praise. I praise you for myself, now I praise you with my brother. I worship you alone, now I worship you with my brother. We glorify you. We lift up the Lamb of God. We honor him. We give him glory and praise. We magnify him because he's worthy. It was nobody but the Lord that brought us through. And we glorify him. And we thank him. And we lift him up. Lift him up. Lift him up on death row. Lift him up wherever you're listening. In the cafeterias, in the hallways. Just lift him up. He's the Lamb of God. Glory. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Sing. Hallelujah. Yes. Sing, brother. Sing. Sing. Lift it, lift it, lift it, lift it, lift it. Sweet love. Thank you. the final moments, in the final moments of this service. If you're in this room and you don't know Jesus, I feel his presence all over the room. If you're here and you don't know him, I want you to slip into this center aisle and come walking up here. Pay absolutely no attention to any of these people. Give your life to Jesus Christ. If you're listening in the cells, you're locked up, you need Jesus. You might not can get out, but I declare he can get in. He'll come right on death row and any other row. He'll give you life and strength and peace. Right where you are, you need to just bow your head and open your heart and allow the Holy Spirit to come into your life. I want to call every backslider to this altar. Every person who wants Jesus, just come while we pray. I'm going to pray for those that are listening over intercom systems, who are watching television screens. Wherever you are, God cares. God cares. God cares. O Lamb of God, sing it just one more time. The Lamb of God. He loves you. He loves you. You're somebody's baby. Somebody's son. Some grandmama's prayer. Just dream. And the Holy Spirit comes to restore you and to renew you and to lift you up. Somebody's brother. Oh God. Somebody's daddy. Hallelujah. I lift you up to Jesus. Come into each heart in a fresh way, in a real way. You just pray with me, Lord, I give my heart to you. Lord, I surrender my life to you. Tell him, Lord, I surrender my life to you. I believe you died for my sins. I believe you died for the mistakes I made. I can't undo them, but you died for people who made mistakes. And I thank you for mercy. The world may never forget. The system may not never forget, but I thank you for the blood that washes away my sins. And God, in the name of Jesus, fill every soul with your spirit and your glory. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost fall supernaturally. Let us never be the same again. Hallelujah. From this day forward, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to live for you. I'll live for you till I don't live anymore. When I lay down my life, I'll die for you. Some sweet morning after a while, I'll wake up in glory. I trust you. You're the God of San Quentin too. Come into each heart. Come into each cell. Rock your sons to sleep and give them peace. I pray today that somebody's nightmares would stop today and that the peace and the power of God would give them the grace to keep on living. And keep on giving and lose his fear in the presence of the King, the mighty King, King Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Today, I know my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm your child. In Jesus' name. Thank God for the Lamb. Thank God for the Lamb. Thank Him all in the prison. Thank Him all in the cells. Thank Him in the chapel. Oh, Lamb of God. Yes. Come on, give Him glory and praise. You know how to worship now. Come on, worship. Worship Him. Worship Him. Well, give Him praise, my brothers. Let's rejoice. Yeah.
You that are at the altar, before you go back to your seats, there's some gentlemen on the side. I want you to, and there's some in the middle with a pad. There's some over here. You that were at the altar, I just want you to stop by and give them your name. And you that are watching by closed circuit TV, or you that are watching from the ranch or from H Block, if you made a decision when Bishop was praying, and you came to the altar right there in that cell, or you came to the altar down there at the ranch, and you made a decision, I want you to write to Chaplain Earl Smith. Give it to them because we want to hear from you. They want to hear from you. The same Spirit that dwells at this altar, that ministered to them and sealed them through the power of the Holy Spirit, will come into your cell and seal you. You that are on death row, you could be sealed by that same Spirit. So write to Chaplain Earl Smith and let him know the decision you made. And you, before you go back to your seat, make sure you stop at one of these gentlemen here and let them know so that they could follow up on you. This is just the beginning of your destiny. And God wants to do something in your life. This is just the beginning. We need to help bear one another's burdens. And so I want you to just let them know, start fellowshipping together. Help one another. Was it good for you this morning? Yeah. Come on, has He blessed you? Yeah. Did He take you into the presence of the Lord this morning? Did He let you know that we got to give Him more than just our body? Come on, we got to worship Him because He's worthy to be worshiped. We got to stop trying to pay Him off. But we got to give Him all of us, spirit to spirit. Come on, didn't Bishop take us there this morning? Hallelujah. Father, we thank You now for this man of God. We pray that You replenish, Father, and restore back to him that which He's poured out upon us. God, I pray You'll keep him filled. I pray right now in the name of Jesus, O God, that You'll rejuvenate his spirit, O God. You'll renew his strength. And God, You'll just do whatever needs to be done to keep him, Father. Because we believe that that which we commit to You, You're able to keep until the day of Jesus Christ. Keep this precious man of God. Lord, we thank You. We praise You. We give You the honor and the glory. Now listen, in a moment, we're going to dismiss you. And we're going to go and have lunch, I guess, and we'll be back at 1, y'all. Even at lunch, continue to worship Him. So you can even worship Him while you eat. You can be worshiping Him when you're going back to your dormitory, to your cell. And I tell you, people are starting looking at you like you're crazy. And they'll say, what do they have? I want to come and get some of that. And there's some people here, there's some seats that are empty. Bring them back at 1 o'clock so that they can get a taste of what God is doing. Because I tell you, once you taste it, you don't want nothing else. God bless you, and you're dismissed to go.
cry.
Precious Lord, I need you to stay.